You will, perhaps, have noticed that the President of the United States and the British representative, in what is aptly called the Atlantic Charter, have jointly pledged their countries to the final destruction of the Nazi tyranny. That is a solemn and grave undertaking. It must be made good. It will be made good. And, of course, many practical arrangements to fulfill that purpose have been and are being organized and set in motion. The question has been asked, how near is the United States to war? There is certainly one man who knows the answer to that question. If Hitler has not yet declared war upon the United States, it is surely not out of his love for American institutions. It is certainly not because he could not find a pretext. He has murdered half a dozen countries for far less. Fear of immediately redoubling the tremendous energies now being employed against him is no doubt a restraining influence. But the real reason is, I am sure, to be found in the method to which he has so faithfully adhered and by which he has gained so much. What is that method? It is a very simple method. One by one. That is his plan. That is his guiding rule. That is the trick by which he has enslaved so large a portion of the world. 3.5 years ago, I appealed to my fellow countrymen to take the lead in weaving together a strong defensive union within the principles of the League of Nations. A union of all the countries who felt themselves in ever-growing danger. But none would listen. All stood idle while Germany rearmed. Czechoslovakia was subjugated. A French government deserted their faithful ally and broke a plighted word in that ally's hour of need. Russia was cajoled and deceived into a kind of neutrality or partnership while the French army was being annihilated. The Low Countries and the Scandinavian countries, acting with France and Great Britain in good time, even after the war had begun, might have altered its course and would have had, at any rate, a fighting chance. The Balkan states had only to stand together to save themselves from the ruin by which they are now engulfed. But one by one, they were undermined and overwhelmed. Never was the career of crime made more smooth. Now Hitler is striking at Russia with all his might, well knowing the difficulties of geography which stand between Russia and the aid which the Western democracies are trying to bring. We shall strive our utmost to overcome all difficulties and to bring this aid. We have arranged for a conference in Moscow between the United States, British, and Russian authorities to settle the whole plan. No barrier must stand in the way. But why is Hitler striking at Russia and inflicting and suffering himself? Or rather, making his soldiers suffer this frightful slaughter. It is with the declared object of turning his whole force upon the British Islands. And if he could succeed in beating the life and strength out of us, which is not so easy, then is the moment when he will settle his account. And it is already a long one with the people of the United States and generally with the Western Hemisphere. One by one, there is the process. There is the simple, dismal plan which has served Hitler so well. It needs but one final successful application to make him the master of the world. I am devoutly thankful that some eyes, at least, are fully open to it while time remains. I rejoice to find that the President saw in their true light and proportions the extreme dangers by which the American people, as well as the British people, are now beset. It was indeed by the mercy of God that he began 8 years ago that revival of the strength of the American Navy, without which the New World today would have to take its orders from the European dictators, but with which the United States still retains the power to marshal her gigantic strength, and in saving herself, render an incomparable service to mankind. We had a church parade on the Sunday in our Atlantic Bay. The President came onto the quarterdeck of the Prince of Wales, where there were mingled together many hundreds of American and British sailors and marines. The sun shone bright and warm, while we all sang the old hymns, which are our common inheritance, and which we learned as children in our homes. We sang the hymn founded on the psalm which John Hampden's soldiers sang when they bore his body to the grave, and in which the brief, precarious span of human life is contrasted with the immutability of him to whom 1,000 ages are but as yesterday and as a watch that is passed in the night. We sang the sailor's hymn for those in peril, and there are very many in peril on the sea. We sang Onward, Christian Soldier. And indeed, I felt that this was no vain presumption, but that we had the right to feel that we were serving a cause for the sake of which a trumpet has sounded from on high. When I looked upon that densely packed congregation of fighting men of the same language, of the same faith, of the same fundamental laws, of the same ideals, now to a large extent of the same interests, and certainly in different degrees facing the same dangers, it swept across me that here was the only hope, but also the sure hope, of saving the world from measureless degradation. And so we came back across the ocean waves, uplifted in spirit, fortified in resolve. Some American destroyers, which were carrying mail to the United States Marines in Iceland, happened to be going the same way too. So we made a goodly company at sea together. And when we were right out in mid-passage one afternoon, a noble sight broke on the view. We overtook one of the convoys which carry the munitions and supplies of the New World to sustain the champions of freedom in the old. The whole horizon, whole broad horizon, seemed filled with ships. 70 or 80 ships of all kinds and sizes, arrayed in 14 lines, each of which could have been drawn with a ruler. Hardly a wisp of smoke, not a straggler, but all bristling with cannon and other precautions on which I will not dwell, and all surrounded by their British escorting vessels, while overhead the far-ranging Catalina airboats soared, vigilant, protecting eagles in the sky. And then I felt that hard and terrible and long drawn out as this struggle may be, we shall not be denied the strength to do our duty to the end.